day. I said I'll probably have a thinner crowd because people have gone to see family. Some of them hadn't made it back, and we have some sick today as well. And we always hate to see when that happens, that we have people sick. And but that's just part of life sometimes, and something to give us something to pray about. Praise God. But I appreciate the Lord, and I really appreciate my Christian roots and Christian heritage and everything that Christianity means to me. I'm going to tell you, you see, I've been watching a lot of videos on this problem they're having over in Europe and places, watching those folks flow through and all the things that's going on, the rapings, the killings, the words, the bitterness, the hatred, the attitudes of people that don't have Christianity in their life. I'm going to tell you, having your kids go to Sunday school and at least learn the basics of Christ, and when they get older, learn the deeper things of God and able to perform them, it puts your moral compass in a place to be successful in life. Amen. It really does. It puts your moral compass in a good place. And I'm going to be preaching a little different today. I'm going to be continuing on the thought. Brother Mike's been preaching on prayer. And I'm going to continue that thought on one more time. This is our last Sunday of the year. And everybody makes all them New Year revolutions that we never do carry out. But I'm going to try my best to make 2016 a whole lot better than 2015 was. And I know there's one way that that can happen. If I can get deeper in God, closer to God, know Him in a greater way, then everything's always better in Jesus, isn't it? The less of me that can show up, and the more of Him that I can get to show up, the better my year will be. Amen. So I feel like I can mess it up and He can fix it up. Amen. But I'm going to try to get closer to Him. I want to live for the Lord. I want to see things of God happen. You know, we preach a lot of things. We preach for quite a while here on just, we've been preaching on commitment for the last month or so. And I think it's good that we do, because that is a very important part, because it's the power actually behind, it's your strength, in other words. It's what gives you the strength to perform what the Bible says, how we need to be living and acting. Amen. And I don't care what we teach or how deep we go, we always got to remember one thing. We talked for years here on Christian character and talking right, living right, using kindness, the fruits of the Spirit. You can never get to the point that you can dismiss the fruits of the Spirit in your life. I don't care how much you pray. I don't care how spiritual you think you are. I don't care how much you talk in tongues. I don't care what. If you're going in a direction and you feel that you know, you don't have to have the fruits of the Spirit in your life, you missed it somewhere. Because the Spirit of God that's in us wants His fruits produced through us. Amen. And we want love, joy, kindness. Everything should come out of that direction. And some folks, when they get a little bit spiritual, they get mean and bitter and critical. Have you ever seen that? Come on, any of you old folks that have been in a long time seen it? I've seen it. I've seen folks, you know, hadn't prayed in a year, and all of a sudden they pray for 30 minutes, and they wonder what's wrong with everybody else. How come they ain't spiritual? And I've seen it, you know. I've been in this thing a long time. Of course, I got advantage over some of you. I've been in it for over 40-something years. And I've seen it. You name it, I've just about seen it. I've seen the funny. I've seen the odd. I've seen the crazy. I've seen the stupid. I've seen the good. I've seen the bad. And I've seen the ugly. Amen. You name it, I've about seen it. I've been around a long time. But I want to see the balanced in my life. Amen. I want to love God, but I want to stay balanced. I want to be spiritual, but I want to stay balanced at the same time. And that's what I want. But today I want to take prayer a little further, talk on it some more, and I want to focus on two areas of prayer. I'm going to be talking about the call to prayer and the power of intercession. Those are two things that I think, if you're going to deal with prayer, that's two areas that we need to talk about, because there is what I believe a call to prayer. And I believe, I know there's a powerful thing of intercession. It's a very powerful thing, and I want to talk about that some today. I'm going to read for a text in the book of Samuel, 1 Samuel chapter 12. I didn't put out a lot of scriptures, because I'm not going to be reading a lot of scriptures. I didn't hand them a list of scriptures like I normally do. I'm today going to be reading a little scripture, but I'm going to be making a lot of statements. And these are statements that are geared to make you think. You go against your natural thinking sometimes, and it make you realize things. So I'll be reading my notes more a lot than I normally do. Usually I take a few scriptures, get down there and preach for 30 minutes, come back up here and maybe look at a note or something. But sometimes I don't even make it back. But I'm going to be preaching a little different today. But in verse 20 of chapter 12 of 1 Samuel, and Samuel said to the people, "Fear not, ye have done all this wickedness, yet turn not aside from following the Lord, but serve the Lord with all your heart." We've talked about that in commitment, living for God with all your heart. "Turn ye not aside, for then should you go after vain things, which cannot profit nor deliver, for they are vain." And a lot of times we do spend a lot of our time chasing vain things. "And the Lord will not forsake his people for his great name's sake, because it hath pleased the Lord to make you his people." Then it's a scripture I really want to read the next two. "Moreover, as for me, God forbid that I should sin against the Lord in ceasing to pray for you." So there is actually a sin of prayerlessness. "God forbid that I should sin against the Lord in ceasing to pray for you. And I will teach you the good and the right way. Only fear the Lord." Well, that means reverence the Lord. It don't mean just hunker down the corner in fear. That means reverence the Lord. Respect the Lord. Have a fear, a reverence type fear of God. "And serve him in truth with all your heart. For consider how great things he has done for you." And then in the book of Psalms 27... I'm going to read a few scattered scriptures there. I'd like to read the whole chapter. Actually, I had the whole chapter as a text, but I'm not going to read it. It's going to take too long, so I'm just going to skip through there just a second and read two or three verses out of it. Psalms 27, we're going to start reading with verse 4. "One thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after." If you desire something from the Lord, sometimes you got to seek after it. How many knows the Bible says seek, and you shall find? Knock, and it what? Shall be opened. Ask, and you shall receive. Now, how do we seek, knock, and ask? It's through prayer, isn't it? Through prayer. That's the way we seek, knock, and ask. And he said, "That I will dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord, and to inquire at his temple. For in the time of trouble he shall hide me in his pavilion. In the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me. He shall set me upon a rock," upon a sure foundation, in other words. And then verse 7, "Hear, O Lord, when I cry with my voice. Have mercy upon me and answer me." So basically, Lord, when I pray, hear my prayers. Then he says, "When thou settest," Lord, "when thou settest, seek my face. My heart said unto thee, thy face, Lord, will I seek." He said, something from God said, "Seek my face." And I answered and said, "Thy face, O God, will I seek." And the last two verses, 13 and 14, "I had fainted unless I had believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living." He said, "I believe I'm going to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living." This is not, some folks think that everything good is going to happen just in eternity with Jesus. Well, that's a misgiving, because they don't understand the power of kingdom thinking and kingdom life. Jesus never intended for everything. He said, "You'll receive 100-fold more in this life, and in the life to come, eternal life. Hello. So he has good things in his kingdom life for the people of God. He said, wait on the Lord. Be of good course, and he shall strengthen thine heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. He's telling us to be patient. Seek him and wait on him for his good things to happen in our life. Because he has the power to hide us in a time of trouble. In other words, he can take care of us. God can take care of us through the good and through the bad if we'll seek his face. And so I want to use those just scriptures to show you that how that Samuel had said, the God forbid if I sin against you when I cease to pray for you. So we don't want to be guilty of the sin of prayerlessness. And then we're going to talk about intercessory prayer a lot today. And I'm going to talk about the types of prayer and the basics of prayer in just a moment briefly. I'm not going to go as deep as I normally do. I'm going to try to make my stories I tell just as examples to get you to understand very short, not detail them so much. Intercessory prayer, you got to understand about intercessory prayer, it's the deepest place you can enter in God. It's the deepest place. It's almost as though the spirit leaves the body sometimes, it feels like. You're there, but you're not there. I've been in intercessory prayer when you're in a place, but you're oblivious to the place. You're oblivious to what's going on in the place. You've got only one thing, and that's the fact that you're caught up with God. And you're caught up in the spirit with God, and the spirit is helping you pray and is giving you intercession, all right? And it's the way the Spirit prays through us. And that's found, to give an example of that in Romans. It mentions it briefly. This is another scripture I'll read briefly for you. Romans chapter 8, here we're at verse 26. He says, likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought. For the Spirit maketh, for the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Now, when you get into intercessory prayer, it's a deep place. And it's a lot of times when I've been in intercessory prayer, you would have thought I was a nut, because all I was doing for probably physically was just making a racket. I was probably yelling out to God. I might have just been saying, oh, Jesus. And I might have been weeping and crying and just basically, it's a deep thing. It's a deep place. And you're really, that's not, it's what's going on in the spirit realm, in the mind realm, when you're in this thing, as you intercede for people and things, is where the power of it is, because you don't really, sometimes, you don't really know what needs to be prayed for. I mean, God knows what's going on all over the world. God knows what's going on down the street. God knows what's going to happen tonight. And God knows what's going to happen in a brother's sister's life. And if he's called you to intercede for them, then you don't really, something you know. And when I talk about heart and mind in a moment, it's not something you just know in the physical mind, but we know the heart is the mind. But there's also, most times, hearts used to refer to the emotions of the mind and what you love with, what you feel with. In other words, the feelings and the emotions of the mind. And with groanings which cannot be uttered, for he searcheth the hearts. He that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. So it's when God intercepts your prayer, it's when God really praying through you. He's using you as a vessel that he had taken his spirit that's inside of you, and he's praying for a situation or a circumstance through you. He's using you to intercede before God on his behalf and on behalf of someone else. And it's not you in control and just your mental doing it. It's the Spirit of God doing it. Now, if you never entered into that place, it's a powerful place. And it's not something that, you know, some people seem to be called to that quite a bit. Others, it's just every now and then that you get in this deeper place with God. And you know, because a lot of times, you know, we are just so anxious when we pray to see something for the sake of seeing it. But that's really not why we should do it. We want to be in the will of God, not just to see a sign of some kind, because signs should follow the believer. When we get in the will of God and we're doing things the way God wants them done, signs will follow the believer. Now, I want to review for just a moment the basics of prayer. Just before I get into some of the other things I want to say. I've done this before, but we got a lot of new people here. So you older folks that have taught this, bear with me. Because some of the new ones have never understood this. And as you go into prayer and start becoming a prayer warrior and start having a communion life with God, you'll feel different things. And I want to try to make some of that make sense to you. There's two types of prayer. And the reason I want to tell you this, because you'll get confused if you're not careful. There's current prayers, what I call current prayers, and memorial prayers. Current prayers are things that got to be answered right now. You know, I mean, it's something that needs an answer. If your mother's in the hospital and she's dying, that's not a memorial prayer. That's a current prayer. I prayed many current prayers and saw God answer. I was in a VA hospital. I've told this story, but I'm going to give you it real short. Praying for a man that was, wife was in my church in Little Rock, Arkansas. I'd just come off a 7-day fast, and I was pretty sensitive to the Spirit. And this man walks by groaning and holding himself like in pain. And he looked at me when he got by me and shuffled on by. Came back a few minutes later shuffling by. He looked at me again. He shuffled over and said, "Are you an apostolic preacher?" I said, "Yes." He said, "I am too, and I'm a pastor here in Arkansas, and I got sick and had an operation. An infection has set in, and I'm burning up with fever. And would you come pray for me?" And I said, "Sure." And so we shuffled on down to his room, and I shut the door, and he said, "Don't have any oil." I said, "We don't need any. Jesus is the oil." Oil is really symbolic of the anointing. "We didn't have any oil." I said, "We got Jesus." I had a lot of faith. I just, you know, I hadn't eaten for 7 days, so I believe God's fixing to do something. So my faith was high, you know. And so I believe God's going to really do, I'm ready to do something. I believe God. My faith was sky high. I said, "We don't need any. God's here. Jesus is here." Now, this is not a memorial prayer where you get down and start praying something, hoping someday it'll come to pass. No, he needs help right now. He's sick right now. He's burning up with fever. When I put my hand on his head, it just burned my hand. He was so hot. His fever must have been 103, 104 for an adult. That's very high. But the instant I touched him, I felt his fever leave. His head grew cold in my hand. Instantly, and I prayed for him. His fever was gone. He said, "Wow, I feel great." By that time, the nurse walked in, plopped a thermometer in his mouth, said, "Wow, your temperature is normal. That Tylenol did it." And so I said, "Yep, that Tylenol did it." I just smiled and looked at him. And we knew it wasn't the Tylenol at all. We knew Jesus had come on. Instead of being in the hospital with that infection for another week or month, he went home the next day. Praise God. Now, that's an instant prayer. That's a current prayer. That's when God... Now, memorial prayer, Cornelius is an example. He had prayed for God, to God to... You know, he wanted to know fullness of God. He wanted to know the truth of God. He wanted to know everything of God. He was seeking God continually. And the angel comes down and said, "Your prayers have come up for memorial before God." And where you prayed and prayed and paid on this thing till you just built a memorial prayer before God, and God's got to do something now. But all these prayers are standing up here that you prayed before him. So he's going to come down, and God sent me. And now you go get men to Joppa, call Peter. He's going to tell you what you ought to do, because this man hadn't done some things yet. He believed in Jesus. He believed in God. But Peter come over, preached Jesus, preached about repentance. And guess what happened? Cornelius received the baptism of the Holy Ghost, spoke in other tongues as the Spirit gave him utterance, and got baptized in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. And met him and his whole household. And it was a big thing, because these were Gentiles. And, man, the Jews didn't like it, you know, because now we didn't, you know, Gentiles ain't supposed to be... Them heathens. Well, we were all heathens, you know. They don't realize they're heathens too. Jesus tried to tell them that when they were here. He said, "You hypocrites. You do all this outward stuff, but you need an inward heart change." But God did all that. But that was a memorial prayer. See, memorial prayer is kind of like the old-fashioned. We used to have the layaway plan. You young folks don't know much about that because you got credit cards. Your credit cards now are our old layaway plan. So us putting it on the credit card, we'd go down there and leave it in the store, and we'd put a dollar down, a dollar a month, that we paid the whole $10. And then we'd go down there one day, and you're paying, and you're paying, and you're paying, and one day You pay a dollar and get this brand new bicycle. Wow, I got a bicycle for a dollar. No, you didn't. You've been paying on it a long time. Well, I just prayed this prayer and it happened. Yeah, but some prayers, you know, they're not current. They're memorial. Sometimes when you're praying, God save my children, that turns into a memorial prayer sometimes. Sometimes there's things that, so don't, what I'm telling you that for, don't get discouraged when you pray a prayer and it's not answered instantly. It just means God's put it over in the memorial side of things. And sometimes the answer to your prayer is, you're going to have to accept what I'm fixed to do, because I can't answer your prayer the way you're asking it. Sometimes the answer to your prayer is going to be, get strong enough to have faith in me to accept what I do. Remember Jesus to go and tell John, don't be offended in me. Blessed is he that's not offended in me. And where don't be offended, because John, you're going to die. And I'm going to come and be the Messiah. Your purpose is fulfilled. You're going to die. They're going to lift your head because the true head has come, Jesus Christ. So don't be offended at the way I'm doing things. Sometimes we have to get faith in God enough to accept what God gives us in prayer. I've had, there's an old thing, you know, God, I forgot what it's called, but maybe it's footsteps in the sand or something. God, give me the grace to change it if I can, but the grace to accept it, you know, if it don't change. And sometimes we have to have the grace to live with it. There's some things I've prayed about for years that I've never got an answer to. There's some prayers I've been praying for over 40 years I've never got an answer to. And I feel like it's key prayers in my life. But I've never got an answer to it. He's never answered it the way I want him to. So what have I had to do? I've had to grow through that. I've had to get spiritual enough to be a Christian through it or in it or with it. You see what I'm saying? You gotta have that, you gotta have the stability to grow through that. Because God has chosen, evidently, not to change it the way I want it changed, but to make me have to get strong enough to deal with things as they are. Does this make any sense to anybody? Sometimes what gets changed in prayer is you. And I just want you to understand that. And then, so there's memorial prayers and there's current prayers. Enough of that. There's four channels to prayer found in 1 Timothy 2 and 1. And let me read 1 Timothy 2 and 1. I believe I got it here somewhere. Exhort, therefore, that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men. This is supposed to be made for all men. And here you have your channels of prayer. This is what you'll feel in prayer. Prayer, basically, is, let me explain it. Prayer is just talking to God. Sometimes when you go to prayer, you're just talking to God, like I talk to you, God, and you just talk to him. Supplication is when the prayer is a little more intense. And it may have some little crying with it. It could be some, you know, it's just stronger than prayer. It's a kind of an intense type of praying that you'll get in that mode of prayer and that channel of prayer that God's in. And then there's thanksgiving. Sometimes, you know, the Bible says, enter his gates with thanksgiving, to his courts with praise. Normally when I start a normal prayer, I start it out by thanking God and praising him. And then I deal with my own self and forgiveness and all that stuff. And put all that, you know, get all that cleared up. And then, but I praise him, I thank him, and then I pray about things. If it goes into supplication, if it's intense with me, it could get into supplication. And if then when the Spirit comes in and takes over, it gets into, actually gets into intercession. Now, as I told you, intercession is the deepest prayer you can pray. Let me tell you something about intercession. It demands an answer from God. It demands an answer from God. I don't know any time that I've ever prayed intercessory prayer that it has not been answered. When I really got into intercessory prayer by the Spirit over an issue that I didn't see an answer to it. Intercessory prayer is a deep place in God. It's something the church, it's one of the most powerful weapons of the church. And it's something the church seems to have lost a lot of sight of, but the church needs to renew that in their spirit. Because intercessory prayer, some of you may be sitting here today because of somebody, some relative, some friend that prayed intercessory prayer, and God worked it out to bring you into His fold. All right, then there's also four channels of approach to God. And you find these listed in Daniel 9 and 19, where he talks about, O Lord, hear, O Lord, forgive, Lord, hearken and do, and defer not. What does he mean by defer not? Every prayer you pray is a current prayer. I don't never stick anything in the memorial prayer list. God is the one that has to put it in the memorial column, not me. I want an answer yesterday before I prayed. You see what I'm saying? I mean, I don't never stick anything off. Now, when he said, oh, Lord, hear, what do you mean, oh, Lord, hear? Let me tell you about prayer. You know, when you go, God's going to hear your prayer and answer your prayer when you're really praying, it's when you get, you said, when I get his attention. No, you got his attention already. It's when he gets yours. How many of you ever been to prayer, and while you was trying to pray, you was hoeing the garden, thinking about you need to take the trash out, thinking about what you had all these jobs you had to do on the job, or how you had to swept your house in a week. It's amazing. It didn't bother you before, but when you get in prayer, all these things come to mind. Because the devil's going to remind you of every one of them. I think he's got a list. You know, but we got to get that out of our head. I'm going to be honest with you. We talk about praying an hour, and you don't have to pray an hour every time you go to prayer. But I'll be honest with you. I went to prayer when I was so messed up carnally. I mean, it had so much going, it took me an hour for God to get my attention. I spent the first hour trying to get all that junk out of my head. And I had to tune into God. And sometimes it happens real fast. Other times I struggle with it. Sometimes my whole prayer is just a prayer, you know. Just a prayer where I talk to God, He talks to me. It never went into supplication. It never went into intercession. What is that? Rain? It's raining on the outside. Come on in the house. You ever heard that old song? It's raining on the inside. Let's get it raining here too. Not that kind of rain. We just put a new roof on to keep that out. But anyway, you know, things distract us, and we're so busy, especially this day and hour. We are just too busy almost in this hour. And your minds are so distracted, you think of all this stuff. You got to get, that's why he's sitting in your closet. He's not talking about a real, real closet at your house. He's just talking about a closed off place. I mean, if you try to get one of my closets, you'd probably commit suicide because something in there would fall on you and kill you, you know. But you open the door, jump out of the way because there's no telling what's going to hit you. But he's not talking about a little, he's talking about a closed off place. Get your mind closed off with God. You got to closet it off your mind with God. You got to get closed in with God. You got to get in the secret place. You got to get in a place that you can meditate on God, you can think on God, and God's Spirit can speak to your mind and your heart. And sometimes it takes a while to get in that communication cycle with God. And so that's what he's talking about. You got to hear, oh Lord, hear. You got to get God's attention because God's got to get your attention. So we got to tune into God. That's one of the first things that's got to happen as we get tuned into God. Oh Lord, forgive. I always pray for the Lord to forgive me for everything I've done that was displeasing to Him. I want to get that out of my way. I don't want that standing in my way while I'm trying to talk to God about things. I need to clean that out of my heart. I need to come to God with a clean heart and a right spirit. And so then I get in, he said, hearken and do. In words, you tell him what you need him to do, and you don't defer. You give your prayer to God and ask him to, Lord, do this. I need you to do this. And so if he sticks it in the memorial column, God will have to do that. But that's the kind of way you approach God. Daniel gives us that. And of course, Daniel prayed and fasted for 21 days, and some powerful things happened where we get a lot of the teachings we get today, and angels came. And of course, we know there was spiritual warfare, and the demonic angels fought against the angel that had the message to Daniel. That's how powerful prayer is. See, angels get involved in your prayers, and things happen when you pray, and princes and powers get involved. Now, I'm going to tell you what. God cares about something when you care about it. He's already proved he cared when he died on Calvary. He already cares, but he starts caring when you care about it. And God's going to come to you when you come to him. You've heard the old saying, you make one step, God will make two. There's something to that. See, God, you've got something that's going to be in the process. But I'd like for things to be different this next year. Then you make them different. Because if you always do what you've always done, you'll always get what you've always got. This year coming up, I hate to shock you, but this year coming up is not going to be any different because of a calendar year change unless you do something in your life to create that change with God. If you pray the same amount, if you do the same thing, if you stay carnal, if you don't change nothing, you don't get any closer, then nothing's going to happen different just because it was a year change. The year will be different when you become different. You can make the year different when you make up your mind it's going to be different because I'm going to get a hold of God and God's going to help me be different and God's going to make it different. God has the power to make next year different and I'm going to seek him till he does. God has power to change some things and I'm going to seek him. I'm going to knock until it's open. I'm going to seek until I find. I'm going to ask until I receive. Then it's going to be different. But if you do the same things you've always done, it's probably not going to be any different from last year. Could get worse. Hebrews 11:6 says, without faith it's impossible to please God. He that cometh to God must, number one, believe that he is. And that he is a rewarder of them that what? Diligently seek him. He's a rewarder of them that occasionally seek him. Now, I could go into big explanation about the word diligent, but you ought to really know what it means. In other words, it's with everything I got. It's the most number one point in my life. I got to touch God. I got to find God. I'm going to diligently seek him. He's a rewarder of people that diligently seek him. God's already ready to do it. He's waiting on us. God's already proclaimed it. He's already given it to us. He's to conquer the devil. He's bound the devil for us. He said, here it is. Now go take it. But it's up to us to go get it. Because if we don't go get it, it ain't going to happen. Now, I know it's not an exciting message because you want somebody to hand you something free. This is a welfare society we live in. We got welfare Christians too. I want something for nothing. But I'm going to tell you, this thing cost Jesus his life. It cost him everything. And the Bible teaches it can cost you everything on the spiritual sense, in other words, to have it. Praise God. Luke 16:16 says, the law and the prophets were unto John since that time the kingdom of God is preached, and every man presseth his way into it. Not waltzes his way into it. Not strolls his way into it. You got to press your way into it. This is not something that's just a casual thing, you know, like some people want to make it because they're afraid they're going to offend somebody with their words. I'm about so sick of political correctness I could puke. There's so much junk going on in the name of political correctness, it's unbelievable. And if you're not careful, it's going to get in the church where the preacher's afraid to preach because they're afraid they're going to offend somebody. Well, I'm going to tell you what Jesus said. Blessed is he that's not offended in me. I'm going to tell you, Jesus' words offend people. That's a biblical fact because that's what happened to the Jews. They were offended at the rock. But those that believed in the rock and fell on him and were broken, they found him. Hallelujah. So we got to understand political correctness stuff, afraid to say anything. See, Paul got knocked down on the road while he was going to see the Christians. But what was he doing? He was being zealous of what he thought was the will of God. But his zealousness was in the wrong direction. He was zealous for the law. God turned him around. He said, "Who art thou?" "I'm Jesus." Once he turned that zealousness around and got it in the right direction, he became a mightiest apostle in the whole Word of God. But he was already zealous for the things of God. He was just misdirected in them. There's a lot of people that's in false religions today that's zealous for those religions, but they're misdirected. In the wrong thing. He wasn't in grace, he was in law. And so we understand Cornelius. What was Cornelius doing? He was a man that was seeking. That's why he found Apollos in the Bible that you know, was in there doing the work of God. He was seeking, was misdirected somewhat, and then they come and taught him the things of God, and then he got baptized, got the Holy Ghost, all that stuff, and then Paul come along and rebaptized a bunch of his disciples in the name of Jesus, and they got the Holy Ghost in Acts 19. But they were zealous. They were trying to walk in what they knew. They just didn't know everything. See, your attitude. You know, Bible, that scripture says, you know, the hour is when the true worshiper shall worship him in spirit and in truth. That word spirit, if you'll notice, is a little s. It's your spirit. It's your attitude. It's your seriousness. It's your diligence. That's those that diligently seek him. You got to get an attitude of aggressiveness toward God. You got to get an attitude of knocking. You got to get an attitude of daily seeking. You got to get an attitude, "I'm not going to turn you loose till you bless me, God." You got to get an attitude of aggressiveness to God. Because God's got all kind of ability and power to give us all kind of things. But he's not going to give them to us until we ask him for them. But he knows what I need before I ask. Yeah, but you ain't going to get it till you ask. He said, "You have not because you" what? "You ask not." You're not going to get it because you didn't ask. We've got to get an aggressiveness toward God when it comes to prayer. "He that hungereth and thirsteth after righteousness, the same shall be filled." You got to get hungry for that. Seek ye first the kingdom. Gentiles seek your stuff. You seek first the kingdom and his righteousness. I can add this other junk to you anytime. I can make that come to pass. I know you need that. That's why that sparrow's not toiling and sowing and being anxious and having a nervous breakdown and worried what he's going to eat tomorrow. Of course, from looks of some of us, we ain't worried about what we're going to eat in a while. And I'm number one. I need to be looking at what I don't need to eat more than what I need to eat. You know, God's called the sinner and wants to see what he's going to do with his calling. He called all, he said, "I'm dying for the whole world." He's called them to come to salvation, and he wants to see what they're going to do with that. Saints have been instructed and prayer, and he's watching to see what you're going to do with it. See, we need a desire to see the move of God. And when we see desire that, lost souls can be touched by the Spirit of God. You know, we can make plans about for church and planning that works. I'm going to tell you, church planning works. I can show you churches that are building monstrous churches. They build in monstrous churches through planning. And planning helps. But I couldn't go to those churches. I don't care how big they are, because they're after one thing and I'm after another in God. They're after a big crowd and I'm after the Holy Spirit. I'm after doing the will of God. I'm after a relationship with God. I'm after something deeper. And I believe God moves on us through the Holy Ghost to do intercessory prayer. That's why in Psalm 65, I read it to you the other day, "Blessed is the man whom God chooses and causes to approach unto thee." You see, the difference is, it's just like when you ride on a plane. You can get in the cockpit and you can see everything coming. You know what's coming when you're in the cockpit. You back there in that passenger seat, you got to wait till that man comes on and says, "Okay, we're now passing over the Mississippi River. Look down to your right. You'll see the Mississippi River down here. Or this is the city of Los Angeles. Look down here on your left or your right. You'll see the city of Los Angeles." You know, but the pilot, now he sees that stuff coming way before it gets there. You know, I'll tell you what intercessory prayer does. It puts you in the cockpit with God. So you can see some things coming way before it ever gets there. And I'm going to tell you, there's some times in this church when I've needed to be in the cockpit because the devil had some things in store for the church, and I needed to be ahead of what was coming, and I need to be aware of what was coming, or we might not have survived it. That's what prayer does. Prayer don't put you in the pasture seat. It puts you in the cockpit so you can see things coming before they get there, and you can head it off. You might not have to go through so much. And so you got to find out what the Holy Ghost is thinking. See, prayer is the power. When you know you're going to get an answer, it's power. It's power. That's what. So don't ever lose faith in prayer. That's what he was saying in Hebrews. Don't ever lose faith. He's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Now, you know, one reason people don't pray is they seem to never get any answers. So they just mumble something to pass time. What's happened? They've really lost faith. That's why you need to understand memorial prayer. I tell you one thing, it'll help you get an answer. It's when you're in prayer sometimes, you need to move through prayer, through thanksgiving, through supplication, into intercession, and you can get some answers. I told the story of how a boy that was going to be a preacher, I didn't know that then, attended our church a few times, and he'd been coming a little bit, and I taught him a Bible study, and he was coming, and I hadn't taught him Bible study yet. Forgive me, I got ahead of myself. He was coming, because once I taught him the Bible study, he saw it. But he was the first one to ever get right divine the word. And he was coming, but he didn't show up that Sunday night. Was in revival. Evangelist was with us. And I said, and it wasn't because, you know, it's not uncommon for somebody not to show up. But I picked up something in the spirit. Something's wrong. So you got to get in the cockpit. We didn't have normal church that night. Sunday night, we sung our songs. But I said, you know, I don't even think we need to have the evangelist preach tonight. I feel a burden to pray. Something's wrong in the spirit world. This is all I knew. I just knew something's wrong in the spirit world. I didn't know what it was, but something was wrong. What is that? That's the call to prayer. If you're not careful, you'll miss it. If you're thinking about the Dallas Cowboys is playing tonight, I got to get home. Hurry up, preacher. You'll never feel it. If anything else is to place God, you'll never feel it. I said, something's wrong in the spirit. The church got out and just prayed. Prayer. Some of them supplication. And I was in supplication for maybe 30 minutes. And then, of course, we all, so maybe four, I don't remember how long it was exactly. I'm talking 40 years ago. We all got up. I was a young preacher. It was my first church. I said, well, we'll let you go home. I went back over to the trailer with the evangelist. My wife fixed us a sandwich, and I said, his name was Brother Eddie Jones. I don't remember if he's been here or not. I wrote all those tracts we used to pass out here. I said, Brother Jones, something's wrong. I said, what is it? I said, something still ain't right in the Holy Ghost. I said, I'm going back to the church to pray. I don't feel none of this. I don't feel like fellowshipping. I don't feel like nothing. I said, I'm just almost crying. I could still pick up the spirit of the moment. It still affects me because it was just so strong. Something's not right. We need to intercede. Something's happening somewhere. There, God is calling us. What's happening, Brother Smith? I didn't even know right then like I know now. God was calling me to intercession because I didn't, at that point in time, didn't even fully understand what intercession was. I just knew I needed to pray, and I knew it was fervent. I knew it was something in the spirit realm calling me to prayer. And so I went back to the church, and I live right behind the church, so that wasn't a problem. Like, you know, 100 yards behind the church, there was my trailer house. And So I just went over there, and Brother John said, "I'm coming with you." He was down praying, "Oh God," you know, and I got to praying, and all of a sudden I got to weeping. And all of a sudden I got to weeping so hard, it felt like my insides was coming out. I mean, I couldn't even talk. I was just heaving, weeping, crying. Didn't even know what all about it, but something was wrong in the spirit. Something needed to be moved in the Holy Ghost. Something was treacherous in the spirit realms with somebody, somewhere, God. Something's wrong. I must know this is what the Holy Ghost that's in me, that's greater than everything else in the world. This is what's happening, and it's not me doing it. You got to understand, it wasn't me. It was the spirit in me pulling this out of me. And I remember thinking, and I said, "God, I hadn't cried like this since the day my daddy died. My daddy fell dead with a heart attack. I cried the same way. And I just, God, I had cried like this." And the Lord spoke to me and he said, "Spiritual death." I said, "Oh my God." I said, "Brother Jones." He got up and said, "Brother Jones," he said, "what is it?" I said, "I don't know what all is going on, but God just spoke to me and said, spiritual death. Somebody's dying of spiritual death tonight. And we're interceding for them. I don't know who it is, but pray, man, pray." And I went back to weeping and crying and seeking God. And a little while later, I got up on my feet and I said, "Brother Jones." He said, "What is it?" I said, "This boy's name was David, had been coming." I said, "David is with a preacher right now. He's with an old preacher that he used to sit under." I said, "That preacher is convincing him that everything we teach is not right, that the Holy Ghost is false, that all this stuff is not real." I said, "And God has us interceding for him as we pray to keep him from being deceived." Oh, brother, I thought all preachers was right. Well, who are the false prophets? And Jesus said, "Beware of false prophets that come to me in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they're ravening wolves." You know, the Bible said you preach, you know, the gospel, then what the apostles preach, that's not right. It's accursed. He was telling not to get the Holy Ghost, not to be buried in the name of Jesus, not to do what the apostles preached. We kept praying and kept praying until we felt a release. I didn't know what happened. Didn't see David Wednesday night. But I went out to his house on Tuesday. And I said, "David," I met him on the road. God said, "I just want about to see if I come out." "Oh, my preacher come by." I said, "When?" He said, "Sunday night." He showed me all that stuff y'all teaching's wrong. I said, "Well, I knew he did, because God showed us he did. But there's just one thing I'd ask." I said, "I just created the right divine word. 2-day Bible said, there's one thing I ask." I said, "Could I come and teach you a 2-day study, just 2 days of your time? And if you don't want to fool with it, I'll never bother you again the rest of your life." "Oh man, yeah, anybody's welcome to my house. Come on." I taught him a 2-day study. Didn't see him Sunday morning. He didn't come to church. But on Sunday afternoon, for some reason, I went back over to the church. We were playing songs on the guitar. We didn't have a piano player. I was the main musician. I had a tambourine. I beat 100 of those things to death. The discs would fly everywhere. You just get up there and you open your mouth, sung loud. "It's all over me and it's keeping me alive." You'd be surprised what you can do with that in a guitar. You do what you have to worship God. We're so spoiled today. "Well, sister so-and-so, that didn't sound good." Yeah, you get prayed through, would you? You get prayed through, it'll sound wonderful. You ought to see what we had to deal with when I was coming up. We was over there playing, worshiping Jesus. All of a sudden, the front door of the church flew open. It was David standing there like he'd saw a ghost. He was shaking just like he is. His eyes were big. I said, "David, what in the world happened to you?" He said, "I was in my house a while ago. And the Spirit," he'd never heard the Spirit of God. "The Spirit of God spoke to me in an audible voice and said, get up and go to the Pentecostal church." And he said, "Here I am." I said, "Do you want the Holy Ghost?" He said, "I sure do." Well, he headed right down that altar. Why was he there? Because the church shut down service one night in order to do the will of God and simply pray until we fell into total intercession for David and his family. And he went on to become an apostolic preacher. Hallelujah. Woo! God knows what he's doing. If the church, you know what needs to happen today? We need to get connected to him. That's what really needs to happen. You want to see some powerful move? Get connected to him. I'm going to tell you, he is the power. He is the glory. He is the everlasting life. He is everything you need in life. Get connected to him. Let him take us over. Do some weird things sometimes, like not even have church. You know, we've had times right here we didn't get to have church. When we had church three times, one Sunday morning we was going to have church. Well, we didn't get to have church. All of a sudden, this thing went into intercessory prayer and was the most powerful, awesome thing. I was supposed to leave to go to Virginia. And I didn't know it, but I can tell you the story now. I didn't know it, but the devil had planned to wreck my plane. And we figured it all out through intercession. And we got in intercessory prayer. And that whole service for 2 or 3 hours was nothing but prayer and intercession before God. And my wife was so interceding for me that I didn't even recognize her voice. I could just tell it was a female. As I stood there, we could tell somebody was praying for me. And we picked it up. And Michael picked up something about it. Said, "This is something like Zohar. I said, "That's part of the Kabbalah. That's something I'm going to go and reveal as satanic in this meeting." And that spirit had come from hell to try to kill me and not want to get this stuff out, what was really going on in that stuff. And so Satan hates it when people connect into truth. I'm going to tell you right now. And has got the guts to preach about it. He had planned to kill me. And they was interceding for me. And when the Sunday school kids come out, it never slacked up. It just kept moving. And there was a woman kept getting against my legs, speaking in tongues so loud, it made me nervous. I kind of almost got out of the spirit. I thought, God, a woman shouldn't be touching me like that. I'd move over a little bit. She'd be right back up against my leg, and I'd move over a little more. Finally, I wanted to see who this woman was. It was speaking in tongues. I looked down, it was my wife. What had happened, she didn't even know, because the Holy Ghost had took this thing over and God was praying through her. I'm going to tell you, friend, I'm going to tell you right now, if God could ever get a hold of something. And you know what? God broke that thing. And my plane made it safely. And we sailed in and I preached, and that was the first thing, the first set of series that I got out on these truth about end time prophecy. And God knew it was going to happen. And he brought it all to pass and he made it happen in real. So we understand, if you can ever hook into what the mind of the Spirit is, that's a powerful thing. Because sometimes, it's physical life and physical death. Sometimes, as in David's case, it's spiritual life and spiritual death. But intercessory prayer can break it every time. Because God is going to use his intercessors to break the power of darkness. And when God breaks the power of darkness, it will be through his intercessors. Because he's already went to Calvary and paid the price. But you know what? He put the ministry of reconciliation on his people. And he said, "Now you go, hallelujah, and take this gospel to the world. And I'm going to work through you. If you don't go, they won't hear. How can they hear without a preacher? And how's he going to preach except he be sent?" You're going to hear it from a man, the Son of God. It's what you're going to do when you hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's a powerful thing. I've watched God save my life so many times. Oh, God. Hallelujah. Praise God. See, intercessory prayer can move mountains. We were moving mountains when we was praying intercession for prayer. We were changing destinies. Hello? We were changing destinies when you get into intercession. So you don't have to let circumstances rule your life. We need to get like Jacob and say, God, I'm going to get a hold of you, and I'm not going to let go till you bless me. Because I'm going to tell you, friend, if you ever pray intercession for prayer, you won't want to turn loose until you've moved it. Remember when Shalane got attacked by that demonic spirit over there, when all them people got the Holy Ghost, and I stopped the service here and said, my daughter's being attacked by demonic spirit, my granddaughter, we got to pray. And this whole church in one unison fell in prayer, and we sought God. We stopped the whole service and sought God. And the Lord spoke to me, and I didn't even know what was going on. They hadn't told me no detail, but the Lord spoke to me praying right there in that chair I used to keep right there. And he said, spiritual attack. It's a demonic attack, is what he said. I got up and said, we're praying against a demonic attack of some type. And it would, hadn't prayed just but a few minutes later. It didn't take long. I mean, 10, 15 minutes is all it was. And I felt the release in the spirit. I felt the release. I felt a let go, like that mountain has been moved. And I said, I feel like there's been a release in the spirit. God took care of whatever we was praying for. And that demonic spirit was choking my granddaughter to death. And just as soon as I got up and said that, my wife come out of the office, she answered the phone, and she said, that was Mike or Shannon, one of them over there had called. Said, Shalane's okay. God's took care of it. This granddaughter I visited Christmas may not even be alive if it wasn't for the power of God. And intercessory prayer when the saints... That's the reason when the saints got in prayer when Peter was in prison. That's the reason the angels got released and go and put all the guards to sleep and open the doors of their own accord. And Peter walked right out of that prison cell. Let me tell you something. There is no physical substance on earth that's powerful enough to stop intercessory prayer. None. That's why sometimes when the saints were going to be killed overseas in the missionary countries and the guys pulled their guns, they've actually shot them. And I've heard varying tales. Some of them the guns didn't fire. Others the gun fired and the bullets didn't hurt them. Yet some have died under the same circumstances. But somebody prayed intercessory prayer. I even saw one shirt held up at a general conference one time that was full of holes. And they said this preacher right here had it on when it was shot. Had bullet holes in the front, bullet holes in the back, and he didn't know bullet holes in him. Now you go figure that one out with your mind. And when you get through, all you're going to be is confused unless you really believe in the deep things of God. Because I'm telling you, the Bible says nothing. If you believe, nothing shall be impossible to you. Somebody said, well, you believe that Jonah was really swallowed by a whale? I said, if my Bible said Jonah swallowed a whale, I'd believe it. Don't come talking to me about not believing my Bible. I've done found it to be true too many times. You see, here's the simple thing of the Bible. If you believe God and you got enough faith and enough walk with God, all things is possible to him that would believe, and anything can happen in the supernatural realm, because you're not dealing with just a man. You're dealing with God, and God rules the nations. He rules the air. He rules the earth. He rules everything. Amen. He's not a man. He's God. Can't go to figuring stuff out in the carnal mind. You wouldn't believe nothing. Jacob said, I'm just going to get a hold of God. And you know what it did? It not only did God bless him and save Jacob's life, but God changed Jacob. He changed his name and made him the father of many nations through intercessory prayer. You see, intercessory prayer is not just going to change those you're praying for. Because before you're going to pray intercessory prayer, God's got to change you. And intercessory prayer is going to change you. Because there's a call to prayer. that goes out for saints. If we could just all get sensitive to that call to prayer, you'd be called to prayer a whole lot more than you ever realize it. Amen. A lot of things would happen better if we could hear the call to prayer. And like the Pakistanians, you know, all those Muslims, they hear that horn, they hear that call to prayer. They all go to prayer same time today. And them guys, some of them are nothing but heathens. When they're coming through these other countries, because Muhammad, he taught to rape, to kill. You know, if you ain't Muslim, it don't matter. The Quran itself says to kill everybody that's not a Muslim, basically. I just said about 8 scriptures together. But it tells you, don't make friends with a heathen, kill the infidel, behead all the infidels that's not Muslim. That's why they stop those buses. You a Muslim? Nope. Everybody don't have a Muslim headgear, they take them out and kill them. They're going to invade Europe. They're invading Europe right now by the thousands, hundreds of thousands. And they tell them, we're going to take over Europe. In 20 years, there'll be nothing here but Muslims. They're raping and killing. Raping 7-year-old girls. Raping all kind of women. Just, there's no morals in that. I'm going to tell you, I'm glad my God's not like that. Amen. You know, Allah is not God. Jesus is God. Allah is not Jesus. Somebody said, Allah's Jesus. No, he ain't either. Allah had one philosophy. Jesus is another. Muhammad, he taught people to rape and to kill and to make it. It's not God's will to go out and make people Christians. God give us a free choice. He wants you if you want him. He's not going to make anybody be a Christian. He never wants it that way. That's like a shotgun wedding. I ain't marrying no gal. With her daddy there with a shotgun, you marry, I'm going to kill you. If I may marry, but I'm going to divorce her as soon as you get out of sight. You know, I don't want no marriage like that. I want to marry because I want to, you know. I saw a picture this morning where a 56-year-old Muslim prince is marrying his 6-year-old bride. Makes you want to throw up about all you can do. But you'll just see those videos of what he's doing. I saw them on Facebook the other day. It's just what they're tearing those countries to pieces, the way they're demonizing them places. It's just awful. I don't want it here in America. I promise you that. I do not want it here. And I'm not saying all Muslims are bad. You know, there's some that's sincere. They don't believe what all that says. They've chosen not to believe it. But you got to disobey the Quran not to be radical. That's the bottom line. Because it tells you to kill everybody that's not a Muslim. So, you know, but they obey this call to prayer. And we can't all get Christians to think about praying. You know, we got so much other junk to do. But they don't care if they're on the bus, honey. They're going to tell that bus driver to stop. They're going to get out in the middle of the desert, and they're going to get on their knees, and they're going to face that place they pray to, and they're going to pray. Because it's tough when the heathen is more committed to their God than Christians are committed to their God. But it's the Holy Ghost that calls us to prayer. And we get in all these calls. I've been called to prayer many times. And I've been tying my shoe before. And the Holy Ghost hit me, had one shoe on, one shoe off. And I went into intercession because he called me right then. It couldn't wait. You go immediately into intercession prayer. You know, you just things, circumstances can draw you there. And, you know, the voice of God, when it comes softly. You know, Elijah said there was a fire, there was a wind, there was an earthquake. But God wasn't in the fire, he wasn't in the wind, he wasn't in the earthquake. But then I heard a still, small voice. That's why a person that's always giddy and never has a serious moment, it's hard for them to ever know anything about intercessory prayer. Because sometimes intercessory prayer, there's got to be time of loneliness. A time, you know, sometimes, if you ever had this, sometimes you feel all of a sudden you don't know why, because everything's going pretty good, but you feel real sad all at once. You start just feeling real sad, and you feel like something ain't right, something's wrong. And you don't know why, you feel, you don't even feel good today or something. And just this feeling starts coming over you. And sometimes that's the call to prayer. And Christians don't even pick it up. But a sensitive mother can be reaching down to get that cake out of the stove, and the power of intercession can hit her, and she'll make an altar out of that oven lid. Because the call to prayer is a powerful thing. in a Christian's life. It goes deeper than most Christians ever know. And I'm preaching to you stuff today most of you have never heard about, never thought about, and don't know what I'm talking about. But it is a powerful thing. Sometimes it's kind of lonely to be an intercessor. But you got to be sober sometimes if you're going to hear God. Sometimes situations call us to prayer. And I got to hurry. I've got just about 10 minutes. Situations call us to prayer. And we'll go to bed with depression when that's really set there to bring us to God in prayer. It'll take care of the situation in prayer. You wouldn't have to go to bed to depression. You could take it to God in prayer. See, God won't make you pray. He's just going to call you to pray. And some folks have seared that call to prayer with carnality and materialism. And once you, it's tough. You know, I tell you, you better not sincere that sensitivity to the call to prayer, because God will take it from you. Because see, He needs these people that He uses for this in a crisis. He needs to know He can move on them. See, when we've been attacked by demonic spirits here in this church before, and we were casting out devils one night in this church because some people disobeyed what I said and wouldn't listen to me, and a false teacher come through here and a false prophet, and he was actually sent from hell, and he told him he was casting devils at him when he was actually putting them in him, but God showed me all the stuff because he showed me a vision of snakes swimming underwater and everything else. And we were casting all the devils out of the people he put them in, and as soon as I got through, a prophet called me. He said, "Brother Smith." I said, "Yeah, brother." He said, "Are you fighting hell?" I said, "I have been." He said, "Well, the Lord showed me, and he gave me the picture of all these demonic spirits that come and was coming at us." And he said, "But I forgot what happened, but then where the Lord showed him how the spirit rose up and defeated all that stuff, and he's been took care of." And he showed me that. I forgot exactly what he told me now. It's been so long. But he told me, showed me what he saw in a vision. Well, see, if you're not sensitive, God showed him what was happening in a whole other city and a whole other state because he was in a mind of prayer. You see what I'm saying? And so you got people that enter into these warfares with you that don't even know you if they're sensitive to the Spirit. And God wants us to enter into things in other people's lives. Maybe Brother Jerry's in trouble. We don't even know it. We don't know what's going on. But Brother Jerry's in trouble. Maybe some Muslim refugees have captured him. We don't even know about it. But God could take us into intercessory prayer, shut our whole church service down, or shut your life down, what you're doing, and put you in intercessory prayer for Brother Jerry in Serbia, and you not even know what's going on, but it's the Spirit praying through you. And when God does that, I guarantee you He'll come out of that thing alive. Because God has you interceding on behalf of another saint. This stuff gets as deep as you want it to get. Praise God. See, sometimes God don't do anything until you pray. And some people don't pray till there's a crisis, but you need to pray before there's a crisis. See, God don't just go around looking for something to do. Who can I touch today? No, He's waiting on the intercessor prayer warriors to tell Him. He said, He said, "Concerning my hand, command ye me." This is Scripture. "Concerning the movement of my hand, command ye me." You tell me what to do. Well, the only way you're going to know is to get there in prayer. God's telling us to command His hand what to do. Well, how are we going to know what to do if we just run around carnal all the time and we're never having a moment with God to where we get in our closet and we know and hear the mind of God and let the Holy Ghost teach you? You think He'd give you that Holy Ghost just to save you? No, He wants to save a whole world. He wants us to be used by Him to reach a whole world. He gave this Holy Ghost in us to operate. This brother sitting back here, Brother Bobby, you know, I never met him before, but Brother Lopez did. And he drove all the way from Cuero today to be in church with us. I went through Cuero. It's a long way, about 75 miles up there, because I just went through it twice the other day. Him and Brother Lopez met, and they got to praying for one another. Both of them got in the Holy Ghost. Both of them got drunk. One of the cops didn't come on and arrested them. Now, so. But, you know, I mean, he believes in the move of God. He believes in the spiritual thing. A man ain't gonna drive 75 miles that don't believe in spiritual things. You see what I'm saying? Because you could go, if you're gonna drive that far, you could go to Houston and have a lot bigger crowds, a lot better bands. In fact, half our praise team is missing this morning. Half the church is missing just about it. Do them a favor. Buy them this tape and say, listen to it. It'll help you for the upcoming year. Now, they're out with family, different ones sick, different things, but some of them listen online this morning. Praise God. I'm going to just say a few things. I believe the lack of prayer is the number one killer of the church. Prayer's got to be consistent. How far down in your day on your list is prayer? Some folks can go a week. Some folks go a month before they go to their prayer room. You know, but we need to... Paul talked about daily in the inner man. Inner man is renewed day by day. If I was a devil, I ain't got time to finish this. So I got it in here somewhere. If I was a devil and I wanted to destroy you, what would I do? I'd go kill your kids. I'd make somebody sick. No, you know what? If they're a real woman or man of God, you're not going to destroy them like that. You're just going to make them get more aggressive. If I want to destroy you, the first thing I do is destroy your prayer life. Because if I can break your connection with God, you can't stand on your own. I destroy your spirituality. I destroy your relationship with the real power. You know what it's like? It's like having a fan that's keeping you cool, but you unplug it from the wall. If it ain't battery operated, you see what I'm saying? I'd cut your power source. Then once I've cut your communication, then I can work on you. Because greater is he that's in me. Not greater is me. I'm no match for the devil without Jesus Christ. Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. Without him, the Bible says, I can do nothing. But through him, we can do what? How much?
All.
Say it again.
All things.
All things? Oh, you don't really believe that. Because if you believed that, we'd every one be in prayer every day. And we wouldn't let nothing keep us from our prayer closet. Because we know that's where we get plugged into the power source. And then God can turn it on low, high, or medium, whatever he needs for that day. Praise God. Daniel, because I'm going to tell you, praying people, intercessors, are crazy people. They will dig ditches when it ain't even no cloud in the sky and say it's going to rain. And say, God told me to do it. You read that in the Bible? What are you going to do? He said, just dig ditches. You got a cloud in the sky, dig ditches. You just dig the ditches. God can take care of the water. Hello? You just do what he says. He'll take care of the power. He'll take care of the supernatural. Because Daniel, if you pray to any god other than the god of these heathen gods, you can't pray to your god no more. We're going to throw you in a, he didn't say a lion's den. This is a den of lions. There were lions in there. You know what Daniel said? I'd rather lose my life than my prayer life. He just opened his door and kept praying. But you know what? When he got thrown in, you know the story. The angel of the Lord come and shut the mouths of the lions. and they couldn't do him any harm. Because the Bible said, remember the first verse I said, it said your enemies can't overcome you if you stay in this place with God. He said, I'm going to take care of you. I'm going to tell you, we'd see more supernatural things than you think. I don't care if people don't believe in the supernatural. I believe in the supernatural, because if it wasn't for the supernatural, I wouldn't even be here today. I wouldn't even know what I know. I wouldn't feel what I feel. I wouldn't believe what I believe. Because I'm going to tell you, we need a good revival. Well, we need revival. I'm going to tell you, revival is not just praying a few people through. It's when reprobates pray through. It's when the church gets fruitful in the things of God. It's when the long tongues repent and start praying instead of gossiping. It's when those that's cold begin to get warm in God, gets hot in God. They want to see something happen in God. And they start repenting of their lukewarmness. He said, because you're lukewarm, I'm going to spill you out of my mouth. I wish to God you'd either hot or cold. That's revival right there. There's two reasons you need to pray. If you hear the call to prayer, you need to pray. If you can't hear the call to prayer, you need to pray. Because you've lost something. And it's time to pray. You want to have revival? Do like old Moody said, I'm going to draw a circle and I'm going to get in it and I'm not leaving it till I have revival. Finney said, crawled up in a haystack. Way before he knew anything about the Holy Ghost, he crawled up in a haystack with his Bible. He said, I'm not coming out of here till men this Bible have revival. He stayed in there for days. And one day he comes staggering out of that haystack and somebody said he was speaking in a language they didn't understand. That was before the Holy Ghost had ever been poured out as a nation back in the 1900s. Why? Because if you get hungry enough for God, God will give you something that you never dreamed of. God evidently filled that man with the power of the Holy Ghost. And that's the reason that he's seen all the things he's seen. And people felt all the things they felt. That's the reason that man could walk through a factory. Just walk through the factory and shut the whole factory down. And they'd all be on their knees weeping and crying and praying and calling on God before he walked out the other side. You think it was Finney? No, it wasn't Finney. It was that God that made him shake and quake and talk in tongues with that Bible. It was the fact that he stayed in there until God filled him with power and anointing to come out in people. When he walked by, people felt what was in him. Not him, but what was in him. You get hungry enough. Start hearing the call to prayer. We will have revival. And you don't judge that by the number of people that just get the Holy Ghost. Praise God. It'll take unfaithful people, make them faithful. It'll do all kinds of things. Praise God. If there's anybody going to play the music, you can come back right now because I got to quit. I'm out of time. It's 12 o'clock. The clock won. Amen. I tell you what revival will do. It'll make you quit worrying about things and get a hold of God till he takes care of them. It'll make you turn that television set off and spend that time that you would normally spend watching TV praying. Because I'm going to tell you, I'm going to be honest. In my opinion, this is me, just as an OLT. I don't know if I got any spiritual sermon or not, but I think television is one of the number one killers of prayer. What I think. I wonder what would happen if this whole church all of a sudden said, this year, you know, we're about making resolution. You know, Lord, sometimes I get so tired I just want to sit down, turn on the news or watch Bonanza. You know, I still own, you know. So, Gunsmoke or something real spiritual, you know. But what if we once said, Lord, I'm not putting that ahead of you this year. What if you said, Lord, I want you to help me this year. that as much as possible within me, that I wouldn't turn that on unless it's an emergency situation. Now, if a tornado's coming, you want to see where it's coming, you think you can get on, you turn it on. But unless it's an emergency situation, I'm not going to turn that thing on until I have prayed and sought you for maybe 15 minutes, 30 minutes, whatever you think is good. You say, well, that make me... Well, you know what? I tell you what will happen. If you start praying, when you get that little bit of prayer, you force your... Now, God didn't force that on you. It's something you'd have to make for yourself. It was you that... You're doing that to try to force this flesh into subjection, see? But when you get a hold of God in prayer and you start touching Him in prayer, it's going to make you want to be in prayer then. You see where I'm going with this? And then you're not forcing yourself. That's why you're going to get for you don't care really if you see that television or not. Because what you're getting in here is so much greater than what you were seeing there. And it's going to add something to your life, which that's probably going to do nothing but take something away from it. I wonder what would happen. I wonder would that change this church? I wonder would that give us some of these prophecies Brother Mike was prophesying about a better year and better things if we had every man and woman praying 15 to or 30 minutes a day at least that much. Because some tell you what's going to happen to some of them prayer meetings, they're going to turn into an hour. And some of them's going to turn into 2 hours. Because when you touch Him and you get in tune with Him, because then you lose track of time. Because remember, in heaven there is no time. Eternity has no time. That's why you can spend 8 hours. When you spend 8 hours in prayer, it ain't no struggle to it. You don't even know you did it because you lose. You think you prayed 2 hours. You looked up and you prayed 8. Why? What happened? You eternity invaded time. And when you get in tune with Him, you lose track of time. I've had God touch me for 8 straight hours right there in that office, me praying, walking the floor, praying for 8 hours. I never got tired. I never got tired. I never wanted to quit. I never wanted to go home. I never wanted to leave that place. Because I'm going to tell you, when you touch God and you know God's touching you and God's talking to you, I'm going to tell you, what great, come on folks, see if you can, I don't even know if you can comprehend it. This is God I'm talking about. This is the creator of the universe. And you have touched Him and He's touching you. He's talking to you. What greater thing could anybody give you than that? What greater experience in the world than that? I didn't want to leave. And finally, when the Spirit lit up, and I sat down in my chair, I told you about it. This boy walked in. I thought God had left. I thought he went home. Of course, I knew his presence was still around, but I mean, I wasn't feeling anything. I mean, he wasn't urging me. I was just, you know, I sat down in my chair, and this boy walked in. He didn't know nothing. And he went, woo, just went crazy. I said, what's wrong with you, man? He said, man, the power of God is in this place. I said, man, I thought he'd done left. You should have been here a while ago. And that's a serious fact. That really happened. You see, in His presence, there's fullness of joy. At His right hand, pleasures forevermore. You're not lacking when you're in prayer. You're receiving. You're getting. I'm going to tell you, this church could turn things around for this whole church, this city. Amen. Our county, our area, at least we're responsible for. We could change some things this year if we just get in prayer and let God give us what He wants to give us. I believe God's not giving us what He wants to give us, all He wants to give. I know He's blessed us. I know He's touched us. I know He's keeping us. But let me tell you, He wants to give us more. But I believe He could give us so much more. We could touch so much more. We could do so much more if we just get in tune with Him and let Him work through us in a greater way. Be the most powerful thing we could ever experience in our lives, because it's awesome when God does these things. Amen. Because we don't want to be guilty of the sin of prayerlessness. The call to prayer is an awesome thing, and the power of intercession is a powerful thing. It can move any mountain and cast it into the sea. It can break every chain they was praying about and preaching about and singing about. That chains that can be broken, I'm going to tell you, power of intercession and the power of God. Only the power of Jesus could have broke the spirit. They told them devils, the devils didn't go down there and wrestle with Jesus. They said, Lord, send us into the sea or into those swine or something, you know, rather than into the abyss. And he said, well, go into the swine. They all run the sea and died. You know about the story of all that. But you see, that's how hard it is for Jesus. He just tells them what to do. Do you really believe Jesus has power over the devil? Come on now. He just tells them what to do, and they got to do it. He tells a chain to break, and it breaks. Whatever God says, it's going to happen. He's the Almighty God we're dealing with here. He's not some little wimp over here. This is Almighty God we're talking about. And when the Almighty God takes time to talk to you, and the Almighty God moves through you, powerful things that Seth talks about in that Bible is going to happen, my friend. It's going to happen. I've never had God move through me through intercession and move on me to do something special what he did not follow that up by backing me up and moving in a special way. Because I have walked right in the face of devils, demon-possessed people that run a whole apartment complex out, and I walked right in there, got right in their face with their mouth drooling and slobbering and all that stuff demonically. You don't run into it very often, but this woman was demonically possessed through a Ouija board, because a girl had got her picture and put it under a Ouija board and cast a spell on her. She was jealous because she was pretty, and she cast a demonic spirit on her to destroy her, and she became demon possessed through that spell. You can like it or lump it. I'm telling you what happened, because I talked to the demon that was in her that said in a man's voice, I won't come out. But he did come out, and seven more with him. Where's the girl today? I spent the night with them in Colorado. I stayed in their home for 3 days when I went and got Sister Kay's car, because she's in the church, baptized in Jesus' name, full of the Holy Ghost. Her husband's baptized in Jesus' name and full of the Holy Ghost. They're living for God and going to church still today, and they still love me. Hallelujah. Why? The power, greater is he that's in me than he that is in the world. It's good when you can help somebody that wants to live for God, but spirits has them bound, and you can unbind those and give them the liberty to come to God and serve him. Praise God. Not you really, it's the power that's in you doing it. Praise God. I better not say no more. You folks ain't never going to let me come back now. I went over 10 minutes, but I'm just telling you, there's something a whole lot deeper than what some folks ever touched. I'm telling you, there's a whole lot deeper things in this Christianity than a lot of folks are ever going to know about. And intercessor prayer is one avenue to get there. We want to see things move. We want to see things touched. We want to see things healed. We want to see things delivered. Let God use you in intercessor prayer. And I promise you, if you can ever get in intercession where you're crying so hard, you're weeping so hard, your soul is literally praying, and something's going to come out of you, and you're so deep in that prayer, something's going to move, because the Spirit is using you as a vessel to move a mountain. Some folks won't try to move a mountain with a bulldozer. No, you need to get you a D16 cat, not a D8, a D16 cat, if they make them, and put that blade down, move that book, right? You get an intercessory prayer, son, you can push that mountain right off of there. Because that's what intercessory prayer is, the power to move it, push it right out into the sea. Praise God. You believe this? All right, this next year, don't just say what you're going to do. Make a commitment to God that you're going to change some things in your life to help draw you closer to God. You're going to make some commitments in your life, whatever you feel you can do. It's going to help you to have more prayer. That's going to help you to draw closer to him. That's going to help you to live closer to him. That's going to help you tap into the power of God, and you're going to see great things in God. And I'll tell you what, you and your family will be blessed by that move. Praise God. Amen. Let's all stand today. Amen. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you today for the Spirit of the Lord. I thank you for everybody that's come here today. God, I thank you for your word. Just give us these things that we can have, these promises of power and anointing that you've given us through the power of the Holy Ghost. Lord, I pray that you touch every one of our hearts, that God, what's been said today, at least some of it, would sink down into the hearts and spirits of the people. Let them recognize how powerful they really are, God, and how powerful they can be through the power of the Holy Ghost. And make them hungry, Father, to desire the things of God and to live for God and to walk in the fruits of the Spirit every day of their life, never failing to walk in the fruits of the Spirit and carry the mind of the Spirit with them, Father. I pray you would guide each one of us now. Keep us safe, Lord, as we begin a whole new year. The next time we gather here, we're beginning a whole new year for you, Father. And I pray that it'll be one of the greatest years of our life if we give our best to you in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Greet one another, and you can be dismissed in Jesus' name. Praise God.